مرحبا وسلام على عباده الذين اصطفى، خصوصا على سيد الرسل وخاتم الأنبياء وعلى آله وصحبه نجوم الهدى قادة التقى. أما بعد، if we look in the Sunnah and the Ahadith of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, very rarely you will find that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam has given a dua that is going to be easily accessible until the Day of Judgment. So if you look into the Ahadith of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, there are only few occasions where me and you, by doing an action, can directly receive the supplication of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So just keep that in mind. Once the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was walking with Abu Bakr radiallahu ta'ala anhu. It was the journey of Hijrah, the greatest journey in the history of Islam. Abu Bakr radiallahu ta'ala anhu, the best individual after the Anbiya alayhimu salatu wassalam. They're walking towards Medina Munawwara. Now as you can imagine, the scorching heat of the Arabian desert, Nabi sallallahu alayhi wasallam feels thirsty. Now Abu Bakr radiallahu ta'ala anhu directs the messenger sallallahu alayhi wasallam to the house of a Bedouin by the name of Ma'bad. Nabi sallallahu alayhi wasallam, just understand this, that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam with Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu is the best of individuals after the Anbiya alayhi salatu wassalam. They walk to the house of this Bedouin by the name of Ma'bad. Now Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu asked her the question that here is the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam with me. Have you got anything that we can eat? Have you got anything we can drink? The words of the hadith mentioned, فَلَمْ يُصِيبُوا عِنْدَهَا شَيْئًا مِّنْ ذَلِكَ. The answer was no. Now Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu, worried about the condition of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, he said that there's one goat I can see. You know, why are you not showing us that? Why can I not touch that? So Ma'bad replied, خَلَّفَهَا الْجَهْدُ عَنِ الْغَنَمِ. Oh Abu Bakr, what can I tell you about that particular goat? It's too frail, too weak to even join the rest of the group and herd of goats. Now Nabi sallallahu alayhi wasallam is listening to the entire conversation. Nabi sallallahu alayhi wasallam said, Oh lady, oh female, oh sister, give me the opportunity just to touch the udder of this goat. Now it's the hand of Nubuwa, the blessed touch of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam. The books of history write that milk came gushing profusely. Not only did Nabi sallallahu alayhi wasallam drink, not did only Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu drink, Ma'bad, her entire family and vessels that were to be used for weeks were also filled. Nabi sallallahu alayhi wasallam is leaving. The books of history write, they hear a voice from the unseen, and there are couplets. Jazallahu Rabbun Nasi Khayra Jazaihi Rafiqaini Qala Khaymatay Ummi Ma'wadi Huma Nazalaha Bilhuda Wahtadad Bihi Faqad Faza Man Amsa Rafiqa Muhammadi Liyahni Bani Ka'bin Makana Fatatihim Wa Maqa'aduha Lil Mu'minina Bimirsadi سلوا أختكم عن شاتها وإنائها فإنكم إن تسألوا الشات تشهدي. You have to understand the words of this. Nabi sallallahu alayhi wasallam is walking out and the words from the unseen are, may Allah reward the two companions Abu Bakr and Muhammad. The best of all rewards sallallahu alayhi wasallam, who said that our place of residence today, our place of eating today is the house of Ma'bad. They descended in her house, they inspired her. How lucky is the individual who becomes the host of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam. Oh, congratulations be to the individual, Ma'bad, who got to feed the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam. The voice of the unseen said, Salu ukhtakum an shatiha wa ina'iha. Ask your sister, ask Ma'bad, ask her about the condition of the frail goat. Thereafter the voice said, فَإِنَّكُمْ إِن تَسْأَلُوا الشَّاتَ تَشْهَدِي. If you don't ask the goat, if you don't ask her, if you cannot ask her, then ask the goat will tell you the story. And this was the result of the dua of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam touching the udder of the goat. Now you might be wondering why I started with this particular story. Because this was the dua Nabi sallallahu alayhi wasallam made for the goat to give milk. How can me and you receive and be the recipients of the dua of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam? It's the narration of Musnad Imam Ahmad rahimahullahu ta'ala, where the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam said, نَضَّرَ اللَّهُ إِمْرَأً سَمِعَ مَقَالَتِي. May Allah keep that individual's face fresh. فِي الدُّنْيَا وَالْآخِرَةِ, the scholars of hadith mention, نَضَّرَ اللَّهُ إِمْرَأً سَمِعَ مَقَالَتِي فَحَفِظَهَا فَوَعَاهَا وَأَدَّاهَا كَمَا سَمِعَهَا. That may Allah keep that individual's face fresh who heard the words of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam. فَسَمِعَهَا, he heard them. فَوَعَاهَا, he understood them. وَأَدَّاهَا كَمَا سَمِعَهَا, and he propagated these words. So this is our opportunity in the month of Ramadan to listen to a collection of ahadith regarding the love of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam. Respected brothers, you know this collection, before I even start, it's very important we appreciate that this collection or ahadith in general, how much effort has been put in until we receive this. The muhaddithun rahimahumullahu ta'ala for one hadith, it sacrificed the blood and sweat that was put in just to get the hadith to the ummah of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam. So I just thought that for the next 4-5 sessions, just before we start the hadith collection, it's very important that we connect ourselves with the scholars of hadith. Now the most important, the most famous Imam Muhaddith, Imam al-Muhaddithin, who is the leader of the entire Muhaddithin, is who?
Imam Bukhari
rahimahullahu ta'ala. It's very important we know that, just so that we can appreciate these ahadith, it's very important we know. So remember Imam Bukhari, you can talk ages about him, but very quickly, Imam Bukhari rahimahullahu ta'ala was, first of all, he was a non-Arab. Imam Bukhari rahimahullahu ta'ala, in his young age, he was blind. He was blind. Imam Bukhari was blind. The books of history mention that his eyesight went, and his mother used to make plenty of dua for him that, my son, please give him his eyesight back. I want him to do the service of deen. Now you have to understand, every person has a dua of a mother behind him. And many scholars are like this. Imam Bukhari rahimahullahu ta'ala's mother made plenty of dua for him. Now one day, she sees in her dream that, Ya ukhti, qad raddallahu ala ibnika basarahu لِكَثْرَةِ دُعَائِكَ عَلَيْهِ أَوْ لِكَثْرَةِ بُكَائِكَ عَلَيْهِ. That Imam Bukhari, the young Muhammad Ismail, or mother, his eyesight has been restored as a result of your excessive crying for him. And this became the journey of the great Imam, Imam Bukhari rahimahullahu ta'ala. Now very quickly, just in a young age, he was 17, 18 years old. 17, 18 years old, he visits Medina Munawwara. When he goes to Medina Munawwara, he compiles a big book by the name of Kitab al-Tariq. And the books of history mention that he was in front of the Rawdha of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam, and it was the night and the moon was shining, and he compiled this masterpiece of a book by the name of Kitab al-Tariq. Another thing about Imam Bukhari rahimahullahu ta'ala, remember I'm only going to tell you a few things about him just so you can appreciate this individual. He was 11 years old. He attends the gathering of a muhaddith, and traditionally how the gatherings of hadith used to be is the muhaddith would come, he would just do qira'ah of the ahadith, the audience would listen and they would move on because they understood Arabic. Now the muhaddith, he said, an Sufyan, an Abi Zubair, an Ibrahim. That Sufyan has narrated from Abu Zubair, from Ibrahim. The little young Muhammad Ismail is in the gathering and he says, Akhtatta ya Sheikh. He says, you've made a mistake. So this muhaddith is like, what's this little kid talking about? And he goes, okay, then you tell me if you know it so well, what's the correct one? So he goes, an Sufyan, an Zubair ibn Adi, an Ibrahim. It's not Abu Zubair, it's Zubair ibn Adi. Now this muhaddith is perplexed, he's shocked. What does this little kid know about hadith? So he goes back into his house and he checks his scrolls and scriptures, and Imam Bukhari, the young Muhammad Ismail, was right. This just shows that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala had chosen him from a very young age for the acceptance of hadith. Now, one last thing about Imam Bukhari rahimahullah ta'ala, and then we'll go on to the compilation, is the actual Jami' al-Sahih, the Sahih al-Bukhari of Imam Bukhari rahimahullah ta'ala. Imam Bukhari, before each hadith, again, this is not just one report, there are many reports to suggest this, that he went to Makkah Mukarrama, in front of the Maqam Ibrahim. Before each hadith, Imam Bukhari rahimahullah ta'ala did ghusl, he did istikhara, and then he wrote the hadith. After compiling this book of hadith, he goes to Madinah Munawwara, and in front of the Rawdha of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam, he writes the chapters on his books. So this just shows the acceptance, the level of perfection that he strived for, that he had to present this book to the Ummah. Until today, it is known as the Asahul Kutubi Ba'da Kitabillah, the most authentic book after the book of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the Quran. So that was just a brief overview of the life of Imam Bukhari rahimahullahu ta'ala. Now we shall come to the hadith collection of Hubbun Nabiyul Amin. Now this is a hadith collection based around the love of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam. Just so that you know, my respected teacher Mufti Shabir Hafizahullah has compiled this 40 ahadith, and they're all related to the love of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam. And inshallah, over the course of the 4 or 5 weeks, inshallah, we will try to complete and go over and read the words of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam. But more importantly, we will be listening to the hadith, we'll be saying sallallahu alayhi wasallam each time, inshallah. So each time I say sallallahu alayhi wasallam, like Hazrat Shaykh Nawwarullah Marqadahu, he mentions, if there was no benefit to studying hadith besides saying sallallahu alayhi wasallam, lakafa bihi sharafan, that is a great enough virtue. Okay, an Anas radiyallahu ta'ala anhu qala qala an-nabiyyu sallallahu alayhi wasallam, la yu'minu ahadukum hatta akuna ahabba ilayhi min walidihi wa waladihi wan nasi ajma'in. Anas radiyallahu ta'ala anhu, who is a companion of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, he mentions that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam said, la yu'minu ahadukum hatta akuna ahabba ilayhi. None of you will become a complete believer. So for iman to be complete, none of you will be a complete believer حتى أكون أحب إليه من والده وولده والناس أجمعين, until I, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, become more beloved to you than his own father, than his son, and the entire humanity. Now the scholars of hadith mention that this hadith has included every possible type of love that is available. One type of love that we know today is when a father loves his son. كَحُبِّ الْوَالِدِ لِوَلَدِهِ, how a father loves his son. Another type of love is كَحُبِّ الْوَلَدِ لِوَالِدِهِ, like a son loving his father, the love of respect, and the love like you love your Muslim brother. Three types of love. Nabi sallallahu alayhi wasallam said, until this becomes a part of your nature, that you love Nabi sallallahu alayhi wasallam more than everybody else, you will not become a complete believer. So the hadith is self-explanatory, that for us to have complete faith, to have complete iman, love of Nabi sallallahu alayhi wasallam is compulsory. Now how does this love come? That's why by sitting in the gatherings of hadith, learning about the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam is a great source to achieving his love. So again, I will try and keep it, you know, easy, self-explanatory. Where there is discussion needed, inshallah, I will explain. But the hadith is pretty self-explanatory, that for none of you will become a complete believer until the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam becomes more beloved to him than his own father, than his son, and the entire humanity. Now, عن عبد الله بن هشام رضي الله تعالى عنه قال كنا مع النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم وهو آخذ بيد عمر بن الخطاب. عبد الله بن هشام رضي الله تعالى عنه, he's a sahabi of the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم, he says, we are with Nabi صلى الله عليه وسلم, وَهُوَ أَخِذٌ بِيَدِ عُمَرِ بْنِ الْخَطَّابِ Imagine, the hand of the Prophet touching whose hand? عُمَر رضي الله تعالى عنه's hand. فَقَالَ لَهُ عُمَرُ Umar رضي الله عنه very casually said to the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم, يَا رَسُولَ اللَّهِ لَأَنْتَ أَحَبَّ إِلَيَّ مِنْ كُلِّ شَيْءٍ إِلَّا مِنْ نَفْسِي O Prophet of Allah, I must admit, you are more beloved to me than everything in this world, but you know what? I love myself as well. So I love you more than everything, but there is a part of me that loves myself. So فَقَالَ النَّبِيُّ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمُ The Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم replied, لَا وَالَّذِي نَفْسِي بِيَدِيهِ حَتَّى أَكُونَ أَحَبَّ إِلَيْكَ مِنْ نَفْسِكَ No, Umar. For your iman to be complete, you have to love me more than you love your own self. So فَقَالَ لَهُ عُمَرُ Umar رضي الله عنه for a short while, he looked within himself. And he said, فَإِنَّهُ الْآنَ وَاللَّهِ لَأَنْتَ أَحَبَّ إِلَيَّ مِنْ نَفْسِي O Prophet of Allah, actually, I've just realized, I love you more than my own self. فَقَالَ النَّبِيُّ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمُ الْآنَ يَا عُمَرُ The Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم said to him, Now, Umar, you have completed iman. Now the scholars of hadith write, that when Umar radiallahu ta'ala anhu first said that he loves his own self more than the Prophet, what he meant by this is the love of nature, that everybody likes themselves. But what the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam meant is the love of choice. What this means is when the command, when the wish of Nabi sallallahu alayhi wasallam is there, which one do you choose? So the gauge of how much you love the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam is when the time of choice comes. Whether it's something else or the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, which one you choose, that is the level and gauge of your love for the Prophet of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. That's why Wahab ibn Munabbih rahimahullahu ta'ala, he mentions, حَقِيقَةُ الْمَحَبَّةِ أَنْ تَهَبَ كُلَّكَ لِمَنْ أَحْبَبْتَ وَلَا يَبْقَى لَكَ مِنْكَ شَيْءٌ That complete love is that when you give your entirety, you give your entire soul, لِمَنْ أَحْبَبْتَ for whom you love. So again, this hadith shows the love of Umar radiallahu anhu for the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam. Because we have a target of 10 ahadith, inshallah, I will go smoothly, and inshallah, I will explain. If you do not understand, do ask. أنس بن مالك رضي الله تعالى عنه عن النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم قال ثلاث من كن فيه وجد حلاوة الإيمان أن يكون الله رسوله أحب إليه مما سواهما وأن يحب المرء لا يحبه إلا لله وأن يكره أن يعود للكفر أن كما يكره أن يقذف في النار رواه البخاري ومسلم رحمه الله تعالى Again, the narrator is who? أنس بن مالك رضي الله عنه Beautiful hadith. He says that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said that three individuals or three traits and qualities, whoever possesses within his heart these three qualities, wajada halawat al iman, he will taste the sweetness of faith. Number one, that the Allah and His Messenger are more beloved to him than everything else in this world. The second trait. وَأَنْ يُحِبَّ الْمَرْءَ لَا يُحِبُّهُ إِلَّا لِلَّهِ He loves every single person only for one reason, purpose, and that is the love of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And the third trait Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam mentioned was أَنْ يَكْرَهَ أَنْ يَعُودَ فِي الْكُفْرِ كَمَا يَكْرَهُ أَنْ يُقْذَفَ فِي النَّارِ That he detests that he returns to kufr, that he becomes a kafir, a non-believer, just as he hates and dislikes that he is thrown in the fire. So these are the three traits that Nabi sallallahu alayhi wasallam mentioned. Now there's a very good discussion the scholars of hadith have discussed over here, is wajada halawat al-iman, that what does it mean that he tastes the sweetness of faith? Now the muhaddithun have mentioned that many scholars of the opinion that what it means over here, he actually will taste the sweetness of faith. And there are many stories like this. Inshallah, I'll explain later on. For example, the famous Sahabi who was in Salah and then he gets killed and he gets thrown an arrow and pierced within his heart and then he did not break his Salah. He's struggling. He finishes his salam. And somebody asked him that, why did you not break your salah? Blood breaks your salah. No one said that to him, blood breaks your salah. He continued reading. And he said, at that particular moment, the sweetness of Iman I tasted within my soul. The sweetness of Iman I could feel has been far greater than anything I have experienced in my life. So that is one group of scholars actually say that if a person has these traits, inshallah, it is hope that he will taste the sweetness of Iman. Another group of scholars, they mention what it means by sweetness of faith, inshallah, in the hereafter, that he will see the sweetness of his Iman. So again, these are many, many examples. For example, Bilal radiallahu ta'ala anhu. We talk about, you know, Syria right now. Imam Sab just mentioned, Bilal radiallahu anhu is buried in Syria. He is buried in Sham. Now, people ask that, how is it the people of Syria, they can sacrifice so much? Then a scholar mentioned, do they not forget that Bilal radiallahu anhu is also buried in Sham. So when he was passing away, he said, Wa harba, wa tarba, how amazing. غَدًا أَلْقَ الْأَحِبَّةِ مُحَمَّدًا وَصَحْبَةِ That how amazing is this that I am dying. I am dying and inshallah tomorrow I will meet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So when you talk about halawatul iman, this is what the scholars of hadith mention, that inshallah these three qualities a person brings into his life, then he will taste the halawatul iman, the sweetness of faith. The fourth hadith, an Anas ibn Malik radiyallahu ta'ala anhu, anna rajulan sa'ala an-nabiyya sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Anas bin Malik radiallahu ta'ala anhu, he mentions that a person came and he asked the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, مَتَ السَّاعَ يَا رَسُولَ اللَّهِ When is the day of judgment? Now what you have to understand is, you know all these questions the Sahaba radiallahu anhum used to ask, is a great ihsan upon us. Because a lot of deen have come to us as a result of these questions. And it's a hadith like this that give us slightly hope, and give us slight hope that inshaAllah we have some, you know, salvation inshaAllah in the day of judgment, is because of the Sahaba radiallahu anhum. So this particular Sahabi, he comes to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and he probably had us in mind, that مَتَ السَّاعَ يَا رَسُولَ When is the day of judgment? Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam switched it. You know, nowadays people like to ask as well, where is the Dajjal, where is the Ajuj Majuj? Yeah? So Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam switched it and he said, مَا أَعْدَدْتَ لَهَا What have you prepared for the day of judgment? So he goes, مَا أَعْدَدْتُ لَهَا مِنْ كَثِيرِ صَلَاتٍ وَلَا صَوْمٍ وَلَا صَدَقَةٍ I'll be quite frank, O Prophet of Allah, I don't have many optional salah, I do not have many optional sadaqah, I don't have many optional fasts. وَلَكِنِّي أُحِبُّ اللَّهَ وَرَسُولَهُ But one thing I will admit, one thing I will be honest about, is I love Allah and His Rasul, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, أَنْتَ مَعَ مَنْ أَحْبَبْتَ You will be with those whom you love. Now this hadith gives us so much hope. So much hope that Qadi Iyad rahimahullah, he mentions that when the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said this to the Sahaba, that أنت مع من أحببت, the Sahaba radiallahu anhum said that we did not become more happier in our life more than the day after obviously accepting Islam than the day Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said this. So this gives us hope. That أنت مع من أحببت. And inshallah, by sitting in gatherings and listening to hadith, listening to the shama'il, listening to the love of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, it is hope that inshallah, this is our small endeavor or small effort in the month of Ramadan, that inshallah we can present before Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala regarding the love of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Now, the people of the past, they took it to the next level. When I mean literally next level, Imam Malik rahimahullahu ta'ala, he is the Imam of Medina. His title is Imam Daril Hijrah, Imam of the place of migration. At the time in Medina Munawwara, he started teaching in Medina Munawwara, where Umar radiallahu anhu used to sit for at the age of 17. He's a young kid on the block. Age of 17, he started to teach. Now, you know when we go to the Haramain, you know after 3-4 days, you know you become complacent and you become very, very habituated to the surroundings. That you begin to see the Ka'batullah, it's like your everyday thing, like it's like seeing candy corner, it's every day. Every day you're seeing the Rawdah of Rasulullah, so you lose value. Imam Malik rahimahullahu ta'ala, his level of respect for the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam and love, it is mentioned that he never ever wore slippers in Medina Munawwara because لا ركبت من قدمي إلى تربة نبيه ولا كنت إلا ماشيا. That I do not want to walk on the place where my Nabi walk, just in case that my slippers and shoes go on the place where Nabi sallallahu alayhi wasallam walked. Shows the love that Imam Malik rahimahullahu ta'ala had. Now the gathering of Imam Malik rahimahullahu ta'ala, again, when he would deliver hadith, it wasn't like this, it was a very exclusive gathering. A very exclusive gathering that it was invite only. Now Imam Malik rahimahullahu ta'ala, when he would come to deliver hadith, so once somebody in the gathering came, stood up, and he was listening to the hadith, and this person that came, he was only listening to the words of the Prophet. But just to understand the personality of Imam Malik, his love that he had. Now this person was intrigued about one particular hadith. So he wanted to ask a question. He thought to himself as well that I'll get some brownie points, asking a question, hadith, inshallah I get to go to the front. Imam Malik rahimahullahu ta'ala just got up and he said, get this person out of this gathering. How dare he say the hadith or question a hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam whilst he's standing. And just to show you the level of love that Imam Malik had, that when you come to a gathering of hadith, you sit in tashahud, you listen attentively with the best of clothing because of the love he had for the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam. The fifth hadith, we will move on. And Abdul Rahman ibn Safwan ibn Qudama, قال هاجر أبي صفان إلى النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم بالمدينة فبايعه على الإسلام فمد إليه النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم يده فمسح عليها قال له صفان إني أحبك يا رسول الله فقال له النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم المرء مع من أحب. So this is the main part of the hadith that is there on the display. Now once a person came to the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم doing migration. نبي صلى الله عليه وسلم was in Medina Munawwara. فبايعه على الإسلام. He did bay'ah upon Islam. Nabi sallallahu alayhi wasallam stretched his hand towards him and he started to wipe his hand. So فَقَالَ لَهُ صَفْوَانَ, the Sahabi said to him, إِنِّي أُحِبُّكَ يَا رَسُولَ. Now imagine saying I love you to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam. He's saying I love you to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam. Nabi sallallahu alayhi wasallam says, أَلْمَرْءُ مَعَ مَنْ أَحَبَّهُ. O Safwan, if you are true in your claim, a person will be with those whom he loves. Now the hadith we can apply, we ask ourselves, who we love more? Is it the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam? Then alhamdulillah, if it is not, it is this month, in the month of Ramadan, that we can change this. And the way you can change this is you make dua to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You read about him, learn his sunnahs, implement the sunnah. And the sahaba radiallahu anhu, different level. Once Nabi sallallahu alayhi wasallam was walking. This is one of my favorite stories. Nabi sallallahu alayhi wasallam was walking, and obviously he was on a camel, on a source of conveyance. Now an animal, it just begins to urinate. So the himar or the donkey of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam began to urinate. Now you can imagine the smell. Maybe there must have been a smell to this urine. Now there was a munafiq, Abdullah ibn Ubay ibn Salul. He made a face that, you know, how disgusting is this? Now Abdullah ibn Rawaha radiallahu anhu. And he was the one that came out with spontaneous statements which were like amazing. So he got so angry and he said to him, Ya munafiq, O munafiq, O hypocrite, La bawlu himari rasulillahi sallallahu alayhi wasallam أَطْيَبُ رِيحًا مِّن مِسْكِكَ. What do you know, mate? He said to him, the smell of the urine of the donkey of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam is far more fragrant than your best oud and musk. This was love. That's why Abu Sufyan, before accepting Islam, he would say, I've never seen anybody كَحُبِّ أَصْحَابِ مُحَمَّدٍ مُحَمَّدًا, like the love of the Sahaba radiallahu anhum they had for the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam. Every time he would do ablution, each drop just to get it, Sahaba would run. Not one Sahabi, Nabi sallallahu alayhi wasallam's blood was there. He told him to go dispose of it. This Sahabi, he went and he drank the blood. Why? He loved the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam. The Prophet asked him, what did you do? He goes, I drank it. Nabi sallallahu alayhi wasallam said, حرم الله عليك النار, Jahannam has become haram upon you because of my blood. So because of the love of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, Sahaba did extraordinary things. Extraordinary. That's why, you know, if you look in the Quran, you know, people, they genuinely ask that, if you look, there's not many conversations recorded that like of Musa alayhi salam and Allah. Musa alayhi salatu wasalam was Kalimullah. So many people ask the question, why is it always Allah said to Musa alayhi salam, Musa alayhi salatu wasalam said to Allah? You don't find many conversations of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam. So one particular alim, he mentions, Allama Shabir Ahmad Uthmani rahimahullahu ta'ala, he goes, I had the same question. That if Allah's favorite is the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, why don't we find many conversations of him? So then he said, until I came across this ayah, قُلْ إِن كُنْتُمْ تُحِبُّونَ اللَّهَ فَاتَّبِعُونِي يُحْبِبْكُمُ اللَّهِ. That if you love Allah, فَاتَّبِعُونِي, then follow Muhammad, as a result Allah will love you. That he goes, if the Allah to gain Allah's love is dependent, to gain Allah's love is dependent on attaining the love of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, that sums it up. So this shows the level of love that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala had for Nabi sallallahu alayhi wasallam. So again, I'm just missing a few things out, but again, the ahadith are very, very self-explanatory. Now, an Abdullah ibn Abbas radiallahu ta'ala anhuma qal. Abdullah ibn Abbas radiallahu ta'ala anhuma, he mentions, who is Abdullah ibn Abbas radiallahu anhuma? I've mentioned it before, so some people should definitely know. Who is Abdullah ibn Abbas radiallahu ta'ala anhuma? Close. He was the Mufassir of the Ummah. He's the son of Abbas radiallahu anhu. He's the cousin brother of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam. One very special thing about him is, you know, our deen, it's not only for elders, it's for kids as well. One thing about Abdullah ibn Abbas radiallahu anhuma is he was only 13 years old when the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam passed away. So in the entire seerah, if you were to see, you will find four people with the name who are known as the four superstar Abdullahs. The reason why they are called Al-Abadilatul Arba'a, the four superstar Abdullahs, is their young age did not stop them from becoming masters in ahadith and in the sunnah and in the ilm of nubuwah and the ilm of deen. Number one is Abdullah ibn Abbas. Number two, I've mentioned this before, that's why I'm just testing. Abdullah ibn Umar radiallahu anhumah, who is the son of Umar ibn al-Khattab radiallahu anhu. Third one, yeah, he has to be Abdullah ibn something. Abdullah ibn... No, Abdullah ibn Mas'ud was slightly older, but older people do add him to that, but he's not from the primary four superstar Abdullahs. So Abdullah ibn Abbas, Abdullah ibn Umar. Come on, Abdullah, you should know this. Abdullah ibn Amr ibn al-As radiallahu an. And the fourth one, Abdullah bin Zubair radiallahu an. So learn these, remember these four superstar Abdullahs, Al-Abadilatul Arba'ah. Yeah, the four superstar Abdullahs. That's not your main homework. You've got other homework coming up, but remember that. قال رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم أحب الله لما يغذوكم من نعمه وأحبوني بحب الله وأحب أهل بيتي بحبي. Abdullah ibn Abbas رضي الله تعالى عنهما, he mentions that love Allah, he says that I heard the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم say, love Allah for what he nourishes you with his blessings. وَأَحِبُّونِي بِحُبِّ اللَّهِ. Love me for the love of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. وَأَحِبُّ أَهْلَ بَيْتِي بِحُبِّي. And love my family because of my love. Well, the last bit of the hadith is very important. That to love Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam means loving everything related to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and every individual connected to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Unfortunately, today you will find many individuals who will begin to attack the honor of the Sahaba radiallahu anhum. Imam Shafi'i rahimahullah, he says, Ya ala bayta rasulillahi hubbakum, fardun min Allahi fil Qur'ani anzala, yakfikum min azimil fakhri annakum, man lam yusalli alaykum la salatala. Imam Shafi'i addressing the Ahlul Bayt, the family of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, saying, it's sufficient honor for you, sufficient pride for you, that to love you is far than compulsory, to the extent if somebody doesn't say Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa ala ali Muhammad in salah, his salah is not accepted. This shows the love of the Sahaba radiallahu ta'ala anhum is a compulsory component of our iman and our faith. So this was a very important hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And you know, when we talk about individuals attacking the honor of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam today, if you look in history, our pious elders and you know the four imams we talk about, Imam Ahmad bin Hanbal rahimahullah. Every imam has undergone persecution. Imam Ahmad bin Hanbal, there was a big fitna at the time, and he used to get attacked and whipped. To the extent that he comes out of jail, every day at night, his neighbors would complain that Imam Ahmad is not sleeping because of the pain he's feeling in his back. Now somebody suggested, you know, Imam Ahmad is the Imam of Ahl Sunnah. You know, somebody said about Imam Ahmad, Ali ibn Madini rahimahullah, he says that the same level of effort that Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu did when people, after the death of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, became murtad, the effort he made to ensure Islam is intact, that is a kind of level of effort that Imam Ahmad made when the fitna was there in his time. Now Imam Ahmad had been whipped, and people would complain he cannot sleep at night. Now Imam Ahmad rahimahullahu ta'ala, somebody suggested, why don't you get cupping done? So he thought, yeah, I might as well get cupping done, I've got pains in my back, and possibly there's something wrong with my back as well. So the person that came, the doctor that came, they told him that there's a piece of whip stuck leather in your back, and until we take that out, this pain will continue. Now you can imagine the level of pain. It's excruciating for Imam Ahmad bin Hanbal. Now each time he said to Imam Ahmad, the only way I can take this out is if I hit you. So he was, I'll keep hitting you on your back, and when you feel the pain, indicate towards this. Indicate towards that place that you're hurt there. Now Imam Ahmad bin Hanbal rahimahullahu ta'ala, he was being hit. Each time he would say, Ahmadullah ala al-afiyah, meaning, I praise Allah for afiyah, I've not been hurt there. Ahmadullah ala salama, I praise Allah for peace, alhamdulillah, I'm not hurt there. Now the place he got hurt, now you can imagine, you know when we get hurt, the first thing we say, yeah, you probably know what everybody says, and the first thing, you get shocked. Or if somebody's done something wrong to us, we'll probably curse them. Mu'tasim did dhulm and oppression against Imam Ahmad. So then what he said? When he got hit in the place where the whip was, the piece of leather was, Allahumma ghfir lil mu'tasim. Oh Allah, forgive mu'tasim. People asked him, this person hit you. He's the one who gave orders against you. Why are you saying Allahumma ghfir lil mu'tasim? He goes, mu'tasim is from the Ahlul Bayt. I do not want tomorrow in the Day of Judgment, even if I'm right, somebody in the opposition from the Ahlul Bayt. This is love. This is hub. This is mahabba. That the love that Imam Ahmad bin Hanbal had for the family of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Last hadith, and inshallah we will finish. An Ali ibn Talib radiallahu ta'ala anhu, and Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, akhadha biyadi Hassan wa Hussein. Once the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam held the hand of Hassan and Hussein, a great sunnah to, you know, show compassion to children. So the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, man ahabbani wa ahabba hadaini wa abahuma wa ummahuma kana ma'i fi darajati yawm al-qiyamah. He held the hand of Hassan and Hussein. He said, whoever loves me and loves these two individuals, their father and their father Ali radiallahu anh, and their mother Fatima radiallahu ta'ala anha, they will be with me on the day of judgment. So to love the Ahlul Bayt is from our iman. So may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us all the love for the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. As I mentioned before, inshallah, we will try and finish the 40 ahadith. 40 ahadith inshallah by the end of Ramadan. So at least this is one hadith collection we've been through regarding the love of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Now, there's a bit, like I said before, you have to remember the four superstar Abdullahs, but there is also another piece of homework that why not do, you know, inshallah.
Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Just a few minutes, inshallah, it won't take long. First, ask yourself the question that have you been in a situation, in a position where you want to say something to someone but you don't know how to say it? It could be your parents, it could be your friend, it could be your boss. And you're thinking that, how do I structure my words? What do I say? Because I don't want to be rejected. And then sometimes you will go to your friend or a colleague and say, okay, look, I'm in this situation. I don't want to be rejected, but I just don't know what to say. What do I do? And you'll go to person A, you'll seek his advice. You'll go to person B, you'll seek their advice. Then you'll draft something, you'll delete it, you'll write it again, and it's going to play in your mind. Because you want to make sure that when this message goes across to that person, it is in the best way possible. My friends, in 3 days' time, the days of istighfar and maghfirah and forgiveness are going to approach us. And this is the greatest time for a believer. And we need to ask ourselves the question that how am I going to put my case forward to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? What words am I going to use? How am I going to phrase it? How am I going to structure it? Because there is nothing more greater for a believer than to seek forgiveness from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So the homework which is being given today is that we are seeking help from Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, that, O Nabi of Allah, how do I do this? And Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam has responded by giving me and you the most impressive and comprehensive istighfar, which is going to be put on the screen now. The Sayyidul Istighfar, and this we need to try and memorize in the next 3 days, inshallah. And next week when we have this session, we will get a few individuals to read it out as well, inshallah. Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam has given us the vocabulary. He has given us the structure, the pronunciation, everything is there for us. The only thing me and you we need to do is memorize it, understand the meaning, and seek forgiveness from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allahumma anta rabbi la ilaha illa anta. That, O Allah, you are my Lord. La ilaha illa anta, there is no God but you. Khalaqtani, you are the one that's created me. Wa ana abduk, and I am your servant. Wa ana ala ahdika wa wa'adika mastata'tu. O Allah, to the best of my ability, I abide by the covenant and the promise that I made to you. A'udhu bika min sharri ma sana'tu. O Allah, I seek protection and refuge from the evil of my own doings. أَبُوءُ لَكَ بِنِعْمَتِكَ عَلَيَّ. O Allah, I fully acknowledge the favors and the blessings that you have bestowed upon me. وَأَبُوءُ لَكَ بِذَنْبِي. And O Allah, at the same time, I acknowledge all the sins that I have committed. So can you see you're praising Allah? You're testifying that He is the one who has created us. We acknowledge the favors He has bestowed upon us. We acknowledge the sins that we have committed. And then at the end, Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam has taught us that we say, فَغْفِرْ لِي, that, O Allah, forgive me. فَإِنَّهُ لَا يَغْفِرُ الذُّنُوبَ إِلَّا أَنْتَ. At the end of the day, there is nobody who can forgive sins but you. So my friends, this dua, the days of istighfar, the second ashra is fast approaching. Inshallah, handouts are going to be given. If there aren't enough handouts, then the dua of Sayyidul Istighfar is in a child's gift in year 7 as well. It's the most comprehensive istighfar that we can make. Understand the meaning. Don't just read it. Understand the meaning. It's beautiful. And inshallah, next week we will move on to another dua as well. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give us all the tawfiq. Jazakumullah.
سبحان الله وبحمده سبحان الله وبحمده أشهد أن لا إله إلا أنت أستغفرك وأتوب إليك.